Tonight, we're, this will be our 63rd exposition of the Gospel of John. We're going to be in verses 24 through 27 of the fifth chapter. And this will be the third consideration of the Father's relationship to the Son. Verse 24 through 27. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Amen. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. For as the Father hath life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself, and hath given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. Now, in order for any person to be saved, as you all know, there must be a personal association between the saved and the Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah. That's why Scripture refers to salvation as God calling us into the fellowship of His Son. There has to be this, not just a creedal, there has to be a very real association between the individual and Christ. Being called into the fellowship of His Son, it's also viewed from another viewpoint as Christ dwelling in your hearts by faith. See, it's the same thing, looking at it from a little different angle. Or it's also viewed as Christ bringing many sons to glory. So that's the activity that's involved there. Or you might view it as Christ being the author and finisher of your faith. See, all that's accenting the necessity of association with Christ Himself. This is what we call abiding in Christ. See, it's that kind of association. Or living unto Him that died for us and rose again. There's no salvation apart from a very real association with Christ. And yet, having said all of that, there is a relationship Christ has that's higher than that. And it's the association He has with the Father. It's hard to find words, a relationship. That doesn't seem to me to be a strong enough word. Fellowship, that's a pretty good word. Actually, He's one with the with the Father. We're one with the Lord, but not in the sense that God's one with Him. It's a high relationship. Without that divine affiliation, there can be no salvation. No matter how much Jesus may be drawn to you, if there's not an affiliation with God, everything stops, as far as salvation is concerned. Jesus will not and cannot depart from the will of God, not to save anybody. He will not do it. He cannot do it. This relationship to His Father trumps every other association. If that association is put in jeopardy, the other associations are dropped like a hot potato. This is the truth. People really have to see this. Satan knew this. That's why he tried to drive a wedge between the Son and the Father. He tried to drive a wedge because he knew if he could do that, everything would collapse. It wouldn't hold up. Jesus will do nothing that requires the Father to change. I don't care how bad man's situation is. I don't care what men ask him to do. I don't care how dire the circumstance is. Jesus will not do anything that requires God to make some kind of a change. In himself, we're talking about. In himself. Without this association, we can't stay, without this association being maintained, we can't stay on the highway of holiness. We're left to our own devices. If this doesn't happen, we've got to have someone in heaven with a close affiliation with God, whose affiliation with God is the primary and fundamental association. The salvation which Jesus is effecting or causing to take place is within the perimeter of God's purpose and nature. Neither of these can be violated. God will not allow any kind of salvation to violate his purpose or his nature or character. Jesus will teach us. He'll intercede for us. He'll bring us to glory. As simplistic as that may appear, this truth is largely hidden from the Christian world. They are simply depending on other things.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, no one likes to say this, but someone has to draw attention to it. The apostle told us the great falling away was going to come, and it's come. We're right. Maybe we hope it's reached its apex finally, but all these things are simple to say, but it has proved very challenging for men to live with this in mind. This has proved very challenging. Not that it has to be, but because of false representations that have risen up. Jesus will take his people to glory. That's what he's designed to do. He's designed to safely get us from here to glory. The first thing is arrive safely at the grave. That's the first thing. When you leave the world, be ready to leave. Salvation is designed to enable you to do that. The general perception of Jesus appears to be one of covering up your waywardness so God can't see it. That seems to me to be the view that is kind of common in the Christian world, is Jesus kind of throws a blanket over your weaknesses and so forth, hides them so God can't see them, but that's not the picture at all. That is not a representation at all. To begin with, you can't hide anything from God. To begin with, God sees all. And if he anything he doesn't see, it's only because he chose not to see it. Or to be more precise, chose not to focus on it. If God Almighty focused on you as you are, you'd just plunk down in hell just that fast. That's how holy God is. That's how holy he is. Thank God for Christ. For the relationship the Son has with the Father. Everything now I'm going to show tonight, that everything depends on this.
Yes.
It depends on Christ. God depends on it. Mm-hmm. God has handed everything over to Jesus.
Yep.
I will leave it to your thoughts what you think he thinks of someone that refuses to do that. If God turned everything over to Jesus, pray tell, how are you going to explain you not doing that? Is that explainable? Is that tolerable? Is there some kind of a help group that can get you out of that dilemma? I can tell you there isn't. Not at all. All right, let's look at our text. Of course, we have these words, verily, verily, again. Other versions say, most assuredly, or I tell you the truth, or I assure you. This is God's way of fortifying our faith. God doesn't have to say, verily, verily. God doesn't even have to say, verily. I mean, it's for our purpose that he says this, that he announces this. It's like saying that he confirmed his word with an oath, that we might have confidence. See, that's what God's doing. He's appealing to our faith. The fact that he has to say verily, verily shows how low sin took us and what kind of environment we're in, that God Almighty has to say verily, verily, or I tell you the truth. Why does he have to say this? Because of where we're at. That's why. It's hard for men to believe this. It's hard for men to believe that there's a word that can't be changed. This is very difficult for humanity to see. There's been whole generations that have not seen this.
Yeah.
Yes.
That was even true of Adam and Eve.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
Before they sinned.
So this is whenever anyone introduces a question, never refer to the Word of God in a manner that can move people to question it. By referring to something, maybe it's your explanation for why we have chapters and all this kind of thing. Never refer to the Word of God so you crack a door for doubt.
Amen.
Stay, it hasn't always looked like this, you know, we haven't always had, don't steer clear of that.
Yes.
Stick with the verilies.
Amen.
You're not going to buttress anybody's faith by giving the devil some ammunition to work with.
That's right. Yeah.
This is not in the Greek. Like, who cares? I'm sure you there's no need to go any further with that. Yes.
I'm remembering when Paul wrote, I think it was in Hebrews, that God, having no greater to swear by, he swore by himself.
That's right.
Now, really wasn't necessary for God Almighty, who has proven himself beyond a shadow of a doubt that he's going to do what he said, to swear by himself that he's going to do what he said as a like a seal to what he said he was going to do. That really wasn't necessary because he's been proven to do it anyway.
Yeah. Well,
so these things that Jesus is saying, there are things he says that are not prefaced with a verily, verily, because they're just as true. And then these things that are prefaced with verily, verily, it's like our reminder, this is God incarnate, and he's revealing the truth to us.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what we're going to have to pay attention to.
That's right.
Because what he says is true anyway. But he feels the need to say, I am speaking the truth to you, you better listen up.
Yeah, see, this is because men, ever since sin entered the world, men have had a hard time believing the truth. They question the truth. There are Christians that question the truth, that doubt what the scriptures say. They don't believe God's that serious, or maybe it's a mistranslation or whatever. If God doesn't have to prove himself, he's God.
That's right.
But it's because of this condition. This is why he makes this kind of an affirmation. It's impossible for God to lie. So that, because that's hard for men to receive. See, that's easy to receive if you're reading something you don't have any controversy with. That's easy to be.
Yeah.
But when he says, except you die, well, see, that's a little harder to receive. If you live after the flesh, you will die.
Yeah. That's right.
There are innumerable Christians that don't believe that. They cater to the flesh all the time, even though that's been said by God. See, men have a hard time believing God. And if you've come to the point where it's relatively easy for you to believe God, you've come a long way. And that's where you've got to come. You've got to come where the first time God says something, the first time you're made aware of it, you accept it without doubt. You've got to get to that point. Another time God said, as truly as I live. See, that's the same type of thing. He's appealing to you. Now, this text is going to be a challenging text, I'll tell you right up front. That there's systems of theology that cannot accept. And I was once a member of one of these systems that cannot accept this word. They'll argue with you. If you press this word, they'll argue with you.
Mm-hmm.
He that heareth my word, that means there's some people that can't hear it.
That's right. Yeah.
That's why it says he that hears. That's because some people can't hear it. Everybody heard it with this ear.
That's right.
That's what Romans 10 tells us. He says, have they not heard? Yeah, their sound went out into all the world, but they've not all believed.
Huh.
See? He that hears my word. You have to have ears to hear. You have to have the ability to hear. There's some in the field of sound. There's some high-pitched sounds that human ears can't hear. Like if you had sensitive ears, that's enough. Right here in this room, there's hundreds of thousands of radioactive signals that you could pick up on radio signals from China and every part of the world. They're in this room, right? Mm-hmm. They're in this room. But we don't have ears tuned to that. It's a high frequency. Yeah. Well, there's even a higher frequency than that.
Yes, amen.
And you have to have ears to hear. He that hath ears, he that hears my word. Now, it means that implicit in that means they accepted the word. They heard it, and they're not going to push it from them. He that hears my word and believes on him that sent me. That's interesting, isn't it? Isn't that an interesting statement? He that hears my word and believes on him that sent me. Jesus said, he that receives me receives him that sent me.
Yeah, yeah.
Amen. Yeah, remember we're talking about Christ's relationship to God. Mm-hmm. Jesus will not maintain an association with somebody that ignores his relationship to the Father. Uh-huh. He will not fellowship with someone who doesn't recognize that.
Uh-huh.
Someone who thinks Jesus is here to modify how God thinks about you.
Uh-huh.
You're on your own.
Yeah.
Jesus is not going to teach people like that. Mm-hmm. Got to believe, hear what he said and believe on the one that sent him because he said what he was told to say. Mm-hmm. That's the point. He that hears my word and believes on him that sent me, him that sent me, 15 times Jesus says that in the Gospels. Him that sent me, him that sent me, drives that point home. I'm not like Mary's son.
Yeah.
So we approach the time of the year, you know, Christ's birth. Let's make sure we don't forget that God sent the Son.
Amen.
This is not a season to extol Mary. We honor Mary.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
But we extol God.
Amen.
Who sent the Son. The essentiality of believing in the Father is underscored in Scripture. And no, the Muslims don't worship the same God we worship.
Yeah.
They do not, because they don't have a Jesus.
Uh-huh.
They don't have an intercessor with God. They don't have it. They don't have it
yeah.
in any form. See, we're reconciled to God. We live unto God. We become the sons of God. We're going to give an account of ourselves to God. We present our bodies a living sacrifice to God. Glory goes to God through Christ Jesus. After Jesus has openly and publicly subdued all enemies, he's going to turn back the kingdom to God.
Amen.
See? So God... And we make our request known to God. See, this is fundamental.
Yeah.
This is fundamental. It's possible to embrace a form of Christianity that does not have due reverence for God.
Yes.
Now, I've shared with you that I had once embraced this kind of thing. I did intentionally embrace it. I can remember as plainly as if it happened yesterday when I realized that the Bible was about God. And the first moment of significant conviction I had was, that was 1960. So I've been preaching for 7 years. And I hadn't said very much about God. Now, I went back and checked my sermons just to make sure. Sure enough, I hadn't said very much about God. And all of a sudden they write, this is what this is all about. This is about God.
Yeah, amen.
What God's purpose, how he's making a people for himself and so forth. So this says it's possible to embrace a religious persuasion, a Christian persuasion that has God way down the ladder somewhere. When the preeminent place in redemption is God. The price was paid by Jesus to God. God is the one that offered Jesus. God is the one that delivered him up. God is the one that forsook him. God is the one that cursed him. God is the one that raised him. God is the one that received him. God is the one that exalted him. See? It's all about. It's all about God. Now what does it say about now? What does it say about a person who Jesus said, here's my word, and believes on him that sent me? Now this, I said, now some people can't receive this, but this is the word of Jesus now. This person that hears Jesus and believes on him that sent me has everlasting life.
Amen.
That's the statement.
Before you move on too far, Brother Robert had a comment also.
Okay.
But from one perspective, a person who does not believe that Jesus is the Son of God cannot have him, because Jesus is the truth and he can't fellowship in that lie.
Yes.
He'd have
mm-hmm.
to deny himself.
Yeah. Yeah.
From another perspective, a person who does not believe that Jesus is the Son of God is denying the work of the Father
mm-hmm.
in the Son.
Mm-hmm.
So neither one of those are compatible with salvation.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah,
I think that a lot of people they're not able to distinguish between the Father and the Son, because there's not been a lot of acceptable teaching about the Godhead. Whoever talks about God, talks about Jesus, and talks about Jesus being God, and they don't. You're going to have to commit yourself to Christ to understand that. Mm-hmm. It just sounds kind of.
That's right.
Kind of hard to understand, so I think people draw back from it.
That's right. Now, someone that was reared in a kind of environment I was, church environment I was cultured in, would say, well, you do have to believe, but that's not all.
That's right. Yeah.
The only catch is that's not what Jesus said.
That's right.
Amen.
He said, he that hears my word
uh-huh.
and believes on him that sent me, he doesn't say and obeys,
uh-huh.
he doesn't say, has everlasting life.
There,
there it is. Jesus knows how to say things. See, but this is unacceptable to a lot of people. But it's acceptable to me. I can receive this.
Amen.
He said, what about obedience? What about obedience? Well, ask Jesus what about obedience.
Uh-huh.
Ask him what about it. No one here really has a question about obedience, do you? Does anyone really think that God respects disobedience? Does anyone really imagine that a person who really believes will balk at doing what God says? That's a sign of unbelief. Not a faith. If you can get this thing of faith down, you've resolved a bunch of church problems. Just get this. Here's my word. Believes on him that sent me has everlasting life. It's not that believing is one of a series of steps.
Yes,
that's right.
It's the key to everything else that's done. If the faith is not there, it doesn't make any difference. What looks like obedience, it isn't.
Yes, amen.
No one can put together a, quote, plan of salvation of which believing is one of the steps. This is a one-stepper here.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah. But it's a big step. It's because believing is a lot bigger than what I used to think when I was young. I didn't know believing was so large. But it's very large. You couldn't say this of a step. That's not enough. That's not enough. See, you couldn't say this if faith wasn't all encompassing. Believing is all encompassing.
God doesn't say to Abraham, he believed and so he has everlasting life, but he said it in a different way. It was an acceptable way.
Yeah.
He believed and it was imputed unto him for righteousness.
Yeah.
See, but for the time, this was an amazing thing that Abraham believed the Lord.
Yeah. Yeah, this, until Jesus came, there was no talk about everlasting life. Mm-hmm. Zero.
Yeah.
We didn't talk about it. When Jesus came, there's a lot of talk about it.
Amen.
And you know that professing Christians, this is one of the biggest questions they have, is do I have eternal life? And there's people that this almost drives them out of their mind. I've known a number of people personally like this. They couldn't resolve this. And really, you can't resolve it for anybody else. You can just give them the facts of the case. But see, believing, really believing, requires divine activity.
Amen. That's right.
He has everlasting life, and he won't come into condemnation. Now, those are two very large statements.
Yes.
Has everlasting life, shall not come into condemnation. Other promises to him that believe is he's not condemned.
Mm-hmm.
Another one is he'll never thirst. Another one is yet shall he live. Another is he shall not be confounded. Another is a person who believes, he has a witness in himself. So see, there's a lot of statements made about believing, not coming into condemnation. But now this is before the cross. We understand that, but this statement was made before the cross. But it wasn't made with ignoring the cross.
That's right. Yeah.
See, because the cross, the vicarious or substitutionary atonement, was set in stone.
Uh-huh.
It's an appointed thing; it was going to happen. So when you're dealing with something that's appointed by God, you can build on it long before it actually takes place. And he goes on, he says, now he's passed from death unto life.
Mm-hmm.
Whoever hears my word and believes on him that sent me has everlasting life, and he's passed from death to life.
Yeah.
Now, gee, what your heart wants to say is, that's the kind of believing I want to do. I want that kind of believing.
Yeah.
Where I pass from death, the change happens on my side, not on God's side. I pass from death where I have no response to God at all, no awareness of God at all, into life where I can respond to God, want to respond to God, see, and have life. And then the confirmation that you've passed from death into life is found in your love of the brethren.
Yes.
By this we know we pass death into life when we love the brethren. So believing causes it to happen. Loving the brethren confirms that it's happened.
Yes, amen.
See?
Amen. Yes.
So if you have a hard time loving the brethren, well, get to work on that right away.
Yeah.
So I'm going to pause there because stop there, because we'll deal with this throughout John more. But this is quite a statement, isn't it?
Yes. Amen.
Whoever hears my word, believes on him who sent me, has everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation. And that, if you know those two things, if you know those two things, you'll have peace and joy unspeakable and full of glory. If you know those two things, you will be an overcomer. You will find a way of escape out of temptation. If you know those two things, you'll be able to resist the devil and fight a good fight of faith and run the race to the end. If you know those two things. If you don't know those two things, then get to work on knowing them.
Yes, amen.
Yes.
That there are certain things that always accompany faith.
Uh-huh. That's right.
For example, Paul put faith and love together.
Yeah.
Faith, hope, and love are together in the scriptures. For Bob had mentioned righteousness, that faith and righteousness are mixed together. And so now you see everlasting life.
Yeah.
And you'll see those qualities always in people that believe in. So that continues to enlarge our idea of what faith is. It isn't just that faith comes. It's when faith comes, all these other things come.
That's right.
Yes, amen.
You know, the thing that Jesus is establishing here is what happens when you believe. Now, the confirming of that's the rest of your life. The rest of your life is when these things that Brother Ricky has mentioned, these confirm to you that really did happen.
Yes.
Because all these things, that qualities that are mentioned, are connected with life. Brother Tony.
Yes, I came up in a time when believing and faith were two different things.
Yeah.
That's right.
That messed you up in your thinking.
That's right.
Faith was, they told me that faith was a body of
I was told.
Was something entirely different.
Body of doctrine.
But see, when you're re-believing here, you're talking about faith.
That's
yes.
right.
But if you messed up in your thinking, it took a while with some help to get that straight.
Faith is a noun, believing is the verb. Yeah. Now he starts out again, verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming. The hour. The hour is coming. That's mentioned, that phrase is mentioned 7 times, all in John. It speaks of a divine appointment.
Yes.
This is going to happen at a designated time. He calls it the hour. The hour is coming. Let me name some of those things that were guaranteed. They were not possible. We're not talking possibilities here. We're talking divine determinations. Jesus told a woman at the well, the hour is coming when they that worship will not do so in this mountain, Gerizim, or in Jerusalem. The time's coming where you worship isn't going to be the point. Uh-huh. The hour is coming when true worshipers will worship him in spirit and truth, as compared to routine. The hour is coming when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God and live. That's going to be in our text. Uh-huh. The hour is coming when all that are in the grave shall hear the voice of the Son of and come forth. See, this is on the divine calendar.
Amen.
The hour is coming when those killing the Christ disciples will think they're doing God's service. Mm-hmm. And the time would come when Jesus would no longer speak in Proverbs. Well, that destroys a lot of preaching right there. It's what he said. This is what Jesus said. I'm going to stop talking in Proverbs. Yeah. I'm going to stop talking in Proverbs. Mm-hmm. That's John 16:25. And then when the disciples, he said, the hour is coming when all of you are going to forsake me. And they did the night of his betrayal. So this is a language, as I said, of divine purpose and appointment. It's not a prognostication, like I see this is coming down the road. God, this is not the way God functions. That's the way a prophet, might speak. But this is not God. God doesn't say, well, I see this is coming, so I'll tell you what's coming down the road. What he sees is what he's doing.
Yeah, amen.
He doesn't focus his attention when it comes to working things out on what men are doing. It's what he is doing. The language of purpose. The world is not governed by happenstance. And if God does what he does because he sees what's going to happen, then the world's governed by happenstance. I mean, isn't this right? How else would you explain it? If you're saved because God saw you'd believe, then you're the one that determined whether you were saved or not.
That's right. Yeah.
And that's not presented that way in Scripture. Salvation is of the Lord.
Amen.
In this day of salvation, Jesus is going to affirm that God's turned everything over to the Son. So the Son's operated according to this divine calendar, if I may call it that. This divine purpose and determination, Jesus is now managing, or he's managing that for man's benefit. Because we had to have a man between us and God to survive all of this. And to participate in salvation, we had to have a man between us and God. And Jesus is the man, so God's turned everything over to his rule.
Kevin,
yes.
Talking about the language of divine purpose and appointment, I've been noticing recently that people say predict a lot when they talk about the prophets in the Old Testament, or even Jesus when he said, I'm going to go to Jerusalem and be turned over into the hands of wicked men and slain. They say Jesus predicted his death. But I don't think that's the right word to use there.
It isn't. It's right.
Predict. Because predict, it, essentially, to give a prediction is to give an educated guess based on limited knowledge. Yeah. Jesus does not have limited knowledge of what God is doing. He knows what's going to happen. So prediction is not a part of the story, because there's no what if element of it. There's no unknown facet of what he's saying. So it's not a prediction. You could say prophecy instead, but it's merely Jesus saying this is what's going to happen.
It's an announcement.
Yeah, announcement. That's a better
word. It's an announcement.
Because there's no doubt about it.
Yeah.
So Jesus, he announced something that's going to be made to happen. God's going to make this happen. See, when God purposes, he makes it happen. The hour is coming when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God. Now, as we confirmed in the rest of the verses, he's talking about spiritually dead here. He's going to talk about the resurrection of the dead in the next few verses. But here he's talking about, if any man hear my word, he's going to talk about how that's going to happen. It's those that are dead in trespasses and sins will hear the voice of the Son of Man. Hear his voice. Why will they hear it? Because Jesus will make them hear it. You say, would that mean force? Well, that, I don't go into all that kind of speculation. The point is, it wouldn't happen if God, if Jesus didn't do it, it wouldn't have happened.
Right.
Think of it that way. He'll awaken him from the sleep of death. He'll cause his voice to be heard. And this is a matter of divine discretion. You can't make this happen. There's been missionaries and preachers that have spent their life trying to make this happen. And they'll be the first to tell you, we couldn't make it happen. And then there'd be other places that happened, and they tell you, how did you account? You couldn't put in a test tube what they did and make it happen again. It's because God did it. That the hour's coming. I'm telling you, the hour's coming, Jesus said, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God. See, and John 5:21 says, the Son quickens whom he wants, wills, or whom he wants to. Yes?
Two things a man cannot choose. He cannot choose to live when he's dead, and he cannot choose to die when he's alive.
That's right. Amen. They're both in the hand of God.
Amen.
When the appointed time arrived for Jesus to die, said John 13:1, Jesus knew his hour had come. See? It was an appointed time. He didn't say, well, things are kind of, tides begin to turn. Now my popularity is waning and some hostility is rising. He saw his hour was come. When he prayed the night of his betrayal, he prayed to the Father, Father, the hour has come. This is the appointed. See, we're talking about divine appointments. If you can receive it, when you heard Christ's voice and you believed on God, that was the work of God in you.
Amen.
Jesus did that.
Amen.
Maybe an expert proclaimer of the word, I understand that, but Jesus is the one that gave you that ear.
Amen.
And enabled you to hear his voice. So you heard more than just words, you heard a call.
That's right. Yeah.
Come unto me. It come across where maybe you neglected it all your life before, you neglected a thing, didn't pay attention. But see, Jesus did that. The hour is coming now, Jesus said, the hour is coming when they that are dead will hear the voice of the Son of God. Already at the, and then he says, and now is. He says, it's already here. Well, already there had been some evidences of this already. You have had Peter and Andrew and James and John. They heard Jesus say, follow me. They left all and followed him. You've got Philip and Nathaniel, the woman at the well, and several people out of the city of Samaria, and you got Nicodemus that heard what Jesus said.
That's right. Yeah.
See, so all, he said, and now is. I'm doing it in a preliminary, introductory way now. So here you got a Samaritan all mixed up on in her theology, so to speak. And she was straightened out. She heard the voice of Jesus and straightened her out. You heard Peter and Andrew and James and John. They've been raised up in Judaism. They heard the law expounded every Sabbath day. But there came a time they heard the voice of Jesus. They'd never followed anybody else but John the Baptist. And John the Baptist, as far as I know, didn't issue a call like, follow me. But Jesus said, follow me, and they left their nets. In a business. They had a business. They just left it. Matthew, he was a tax collector. He just left the seat of customs. The Lord said, follow me. What happened? He heard the voice, and he believed on the God that sent him. So he got up. Yeah, there come a time when you got up.
Yeah, amen.
You got up. What happened? You heard the voice.
Yeah.
Why did you hear it? God made you hear it.
Amen.
Why did you hear it? Well, it's because God wanted you to hear it, and that's about as far as you can go on that.
It's enough, though.
What's the difference between those that heard Pilate say, whom would you that I release unto you? The people heard that. And the people that heard Peter on the day of Pentecost. What's the difference between those two people? Some of the people were the same people. They'd heard the voice of Jesus. They heard him pronounce the innocent, and they didn't believe on him. But Pilate saw. They called out, crucify him. Some of the same people on the day of Pentecost, they received the word with gladness. What was the difference? They heard. That was the difference. They heard what Jesus said, and they believed on him that sent Christ. That was the difference, see? God gave an ear to hear. See, what they did because of what Jesus did. Jesus didn't save them because of what they did. You got to see this. He saved, they were saved because of what Jesus did.
Yeah,
not only the laying down of his life, but giving him an ear to hear. God did that. Jesus did that. Enabled him to hear.
Well, they give, we get a little bit of a picture of this, I think, with Saul.
That's right. You know, that's
how
right.
God, Christ just interjected himself.
That's right.
It out loud. You know, audibly, so
he heard
as a testimony to us, but that's kind of like he just speaks to us.
Yeah, see, the type of hearing we're talking about here, nobody turns it down that hears in this way. They always submit. They that hear shall live. That's the promise. They that hear, that's what this text says, and they that hear shall live. So God gave them an ear, and God honored the ear. They heard. Now he says, as the Father hath life in himself. He's going to make a point here. Now some of the translations say self-existent. I don't like that word self-exist. It sounds too philosophical to me. What does it mean? I mean, I don't even know what it means, self-existent. The Father hath life in himself. God doesn't have anything that was given to him. Man doesn't have anything that wasn't given to him. Right? What is thou that thou hast not received? But God doesn't have anything that was given to him. He's the giver. He's not the receiver. See, he has life in himself. What that means is he can confer. Because he has life in himself, He can make other people come alive.
Yes.
Ezekiel said God saw Israel in their blood, and he said, live!
Yeah, yeah. So,
and they did. They were stillborn. Yes.
When he does that, there isn't any less life in him after that.
That's
like
right.
An extension of himself.
Oh, yes. Yeah, anyone that has life in himself, you can't deplete it. Because it's part of him,
yeah.
See?
Uh-huh. Amen.
God doesn't contain life. He is life.
Yeah.
It's being alive to God, that's what makes the difference. No matter what a person does, no matter how they live, all this doesn't make room for unholiness. I understand this. But are they alive to God? That's the thing that counts. Are they receptive to God? Do they respond to God? Do they live for God? Are they aware of the presence of God? See, that's what tells the story.
Yes.
And the truth of the matter is, we can't pronounce any kind of final judgment on somebody else on this. So the best you can do is find out whether you're alive. That's about the best you can do. And that'll take a lot of effort. They that hear shall live, because the Father has life in himself. So in other words, God's governing this whole situation. When men therefore are raised and made alive, it's because of what God has done. Now you've got to learn to think and sense backwards.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Maybe you've come to the point where you know that you're sensitive to God. You know that you're aware of God. You have longings for God. Now you've got to trace those back to their origin.
Yeah.
You've got them from God.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
That's your proof.
That's right.
Yeah. That God's received you. That's your proof. See? And nobody can talk. Once you know this, nobody can talk you out of it.
That's right.
You got it. Mm-hmm. You know, I know whom I believe. Gee, I'm persuaded he's able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. See?
Amen.
Once you know these things. And he gives the evidences of whether you know God or not. He gives you the evidences. Mm-hmm. One of the chief ones is you love the brethren. Try to trace back to God, so that eliminates all boasting, tallies.
Uh-huh.
How many did you win to Christ, you know?
Uh-huh.
They used to say, well, the count hasn't been made yet.
That's right. Yeah, Brother Paul said, I labored more abundantly than they all, but yet not I. It was
not
the grace
I.
of God.
Now, the Father has life in himself.
Yes.
He didn't receive it from anybody. And so he's given to the Son, not to the Word, not before he was humbled. He gave this to the Son because he had come down, humbled himself. He gave it to the Son to have life in himself. See, we're going to establish here that men cannot be trained to respond to God. Now, there's men that got courses now. They got courses on how to bring people to Christ. This isn't how it works. He did not turn this over to men.
Amen. Yeah.
He turned this over to the Son.
Yeah.
See, we're not told to convert sinners unless you turn them away from sin. He that converteth a sinner from the error of his way, James says. I mean, you get him to stop sinning outwardly. But so far as men being made acceptable to God, that's not something you do. You can preach the gospel to them, you can tell them what they should do and this sort of thing, but in the end, the real work is done by God. He raises them up. They're buried with Christ. Men don't bury them with Christ.
They
put them under the water. They can't bury them with Christ, into Christ's death. Raised up to walk in newness of life. That's all stuff that God does.
Amen.
Jesus says he does it. If you hear my word and believe on him that sent me, he says that's when he does that.
Right. Yes. Amen.
Well, what a So he's given to the Son. See, prior to becoming a man, in him was life. John 1:4. That's before he became a man. In him was life. When he became a man, then he gave him this life in himself. He gave him the right to make other people live.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no man can do that now. No, yeah. No man has ever been able to make people alive to God. No,
right.
But Jesus can. Yeah. Jesus can make a person alive and receptive and responsive to God.
Amen.
Amen. Knowing these things really changes how you pray for other people.
Yes, it does. Yeah. Yes, it does. You believe that, don't you? That Jesus can make a person receptive and responsive. He can open their heart so they can attend unto the word. He can do this. Thank God. Takes a lot to simplify things a little for us. Now, this is a technicality, but it was necessary. Since by man came the fall, then by man the raising to life has to be through men. Amen, not men, through amen. That's a divine decree. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. The resurrection has two sides, so like a coin of two sides. There's a spiritual resurrection, there's a bodily resurrection, which is the consummation of the project. The task of toppling sin from the throne required two things. First, men had to be raised from the dead, spiritual dead. Then they had to be raised physically also. Yeah. See, those two things had to be done to undo the effects of sin. Both of those had to be done. And Jesus does both of them.
Amen.
Now his voice wakes up the spiritually dead. Yeah. Uh-huh. The later verse is going to say that he's going to shout the dead out of the graves.
Yeah.
He's going to call him out.
Yeah.
Like he said, Lazarus, come forth. If he hadn't said Lazarus, the graves would have emptied out all over the world. So he's the one through whom we've been raised from the dead. This is why Jesus said, I am the life. That's why he said that. And you've got to think of life the right way. You don't think of life as always existing. It's responding.
Yeah, yeah, amen.
Life, that's when a fish is in water, it lives.
Uh-huh, yes.
Birds in the air, it lives. Yeah, Brother Jason.
I take it this life is actually the life of God.
Well, yes,
it's
it
like
is.
It's an infusion of,
yeah.
It's a divine kind of life. It's,
yeah.
It's not biological. We already have biological life.
That's right.
And God created that also, but this is a different kind of life. This is like sharing in the divine
That's
nature.
Exactly right. Mm-hmm. It's exactly right.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, all other life has a termination. Yeah. I am the life. I'm come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Then he has, and he's given him, God has given him, Jesus, authority to execute judgment. Because he is the Son. Now, when it comes to saving men, there's some judgments that had to be made, some discretionary observations and mandates. Who's the message going to be sent to? There's one decision. Someone's going to make this decision.
Right.
Who's the message going to be sent to? How shall they preach except they be sent? Who will have a minister given to them? Who are Paul and Apollos and Cephas but ministers whom God hath given to every man? Who's going to make the decision go to Macedonia? Who's going to make that decision? Who's going to make the decision to send out Barnabas and Saul on a special mission? Who makes that decision? See, there are decisions associated with the kingdom of God. Who's going to decide who receives repentance and who doesn't? He'd been exalted for to give repentance to Israel. Who's going to decide which ones get it and which ones don't? Or does everybody get it? See, it's judgment is here. Judgment and discretion is here. Whose heart's going to be opened? Who decides whose heart's going to be opened? Men decide that? Have you ever tried to open someone's heart? You know that you can't be done. So someone, that's a discretionary act. Somebody has to make the judgment. God gave that judgment to Jesus. He's the one that makes that judgment. Whom will the Spirit enable to confess that Jesus is Lord? No man can say Jesus is Lord saved by the Holy Spirit. All right, who's going to decide the person that's enabled by the Holy Spirit to say Jesus is Lord? You're going to decide that by commandment? The Holy Spirit is dispatched by Jesus to where they, so if you've confessed Jesus as Lord and a Son of God, it's because Jesus sent the Holy Spirit to you to enable you to do that. Amen. Or you couldn't have done it. Who's going to be raised up to walk in newness of life? Who's going to make a decision? Do you think everybody who's been, quote, immersed, do you think everybody who was immersed has risen to walk in newness of life? You're like, what would you base that on, pray tell? It looks like hardly anybody in our day was. Who makes that decision? Yes, Jesus makes the decision. Judgment's been given to him. Who will be kept by the power of God? Who makes that decision? Kept by the power of God through faith. Who makes keeping power? Who makes that applicable? It's Jesus. He's the one that does that. See, you see why you've got to be on right terms with Jesus, because he's the one that's got the authority to get done what God requires to be done. But salvation puts you in fellowship with Christ and gives you the wherewithal to walk with him and stay with him so Jesus can do things that cannot otherwise be done. Who is going to decide who's strengthened with might according to his glorious power? That's Colossians 1:11. Who's going to make that determination? Jesus is. Who's going to determine who's made to stand? God is able to make him stand. Who's going to make that decision? I'm going to make this person stand. What? See, we can't make that decision. Yeah. Who'll keep you from falling? Who makes that decision? Is everybody kept from falling? Well, obviously not. There's a tremendous falling away that took place. Yeah. Well, who makes a decision who doesn't fall? That's been given to the Son. Amen. Who adds to the church? They were added to the church. Who does that addition? Some role keeper on earth? Jesus does that. He has the authority. Who decides whose names are going to be written in heaven? Who makes that decision? All authority has been given, see? Yeah. To the Son. Whom will the Lord receive? 2 Corinthians 6:27 said, whom the Lord receives. Who determines who God receives? All authority has been given to the Son. Who is the person that the Spirit will lead to mortify the deeds of the body? Anybody? Oh, the Spirit is sent by Jesus. Jesus has been given all the authority. Amen. He has life in himself. He's executing judgment. Every time there's a conversion, judgment has been executed. Every time somebody is cut off, Jesus executed that judgment. And he's been given authority to execute judgment because he's a Son of Man. Because he understands the situation more thoroughly because he walked here, see? So I thank God all the authority wasn't given to see like Gabriel.
Yeah, that's right.
Or Michael. It would be completely different.
Yeah.
Or what if it was given to Peter or Paul? But it wasn't. It was given all authority. The execute judgment was given to Jesus. So. Now, there's sometimes when we pray, we're asking God for some kind of a judgment to be made. But we've got to understand that any prayer for some kind of judgment, Jesus is the only one that has authority to execute judgment.
Amen.
See? You can't decide who's saved or lost, either one. Those are areas you don't have authority to execute judgment. It's possible there's some men were wholehearted, spent their lifetime in a fruitless ministry. Why? It's my opinion. Because that was a decision they made. That's my thoughts on the subject. Because I don't think Jesus ever did send somebody out so they wouldn't bear fruit. He said, I've chosen you that you go out and bear fruit and your fruit remain. So if that isn't happening, someone other than the Son made that judgment. Not my role to condemn them. I'm going to make an attempt. I'm just saying this is how I think. I don't want to do anything just because of my own assessment. I'm willing to settle for all authority to execute judgment have been given to the Son. Amen. Well, you can see what a marvelous text of Scripture this is, can't you? How this relationship of Jesus to the Son, Jesus to the Father, is a central, foundational theme. And if you can get this straight in your mind, so that it's part of your thought processes, you'll pray properly. You'll live properly. You'll have a right expectation. See? Yes. It'll just, we recommend this to everyone. Anyone else have something you'd like to add tonight?
This relationship that Jesus has with the Father, it's complemented and benefits us as our relationship with Christ. He is the Son of Man. You already mentioned this. He understands.
Yeah.
And so, see, this, what Job asked for the daysman, one that knew what God required and knew what we needed.
That's
to.
Right.
And Jesus is the perfect one.
He's the one.
There is, we don't have to murmur anymore. We can just have confidence in Christ, but put it in His hands, and He'll always do what's right.
That's right.
Amazing.
You got to trust His judgment.
Amen.
Take your burden to the Lord, and leave it.
Yes.
Leave it there. He's got authority to do something about it. Anyone else tonight? Yes, Brother Jim.
It seems as though the charge to go into all the world and make disciples, we all know how that's been heard, as though we could make a disciple, but we can't.
Mm-hmm.
So I would think, and you can address this, but the right way to hear that would be, those who are wanting to be disciples, help them, teach them, and in that sense, they are made.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you've got to, he gives you the message that Jesus uses, is the gospel. That's the message he uses. And then as you proclaim that message, and it becomes evident to you, tell them what the Lord requires of them. See, it becomes evident because of the work God did in them, Jesus did in them through the gospel. So the key for us in making disciples is to preach the gospel.
Yeah.
That's how disciples are made.
Yeah.
Then Jesus takes it from there, so to speak. Yeah.
Amen. Now,
been given all the authority to judge because He's a Son of God.
Yes, Son of Man.
To judge. The Son of God, to receive the authority, okay, and then to judge men because He's a Son of Man. Is that saying it right?
Mm-hmm.
He received the authority because He's a Son of God, and for judgment because He's a Son of Man.
Let me
make sure I'm saying that right. I got it in my mind that way.
Yeah, He has given him authority to execute judgment because He's the Son of Man. And the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God. There's where He's mentioned there. But yeah, you're right. The Father judges no man, but hath committed all judgment, well, He says, under the Son.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So both of them enter in. The Son of God accents his role with God. The Son of Man accents his role to men. But both are, yes, you're right, both are necessary. Yes.
I have a thought on what Brother Tony was just talking about. I think this term Son of Man is a messianic title. Yeah. It's from Daniel 7.
Yeah.
If you read Daniel chapter 7, mm-hmm. it actually Daniel saw him receiving yeah. this authority that he's talking
yeah.
about
Amen.
Here.
Mm-hmm.
And this actually, I think it happened. It actually happened or was fulfilled, consummated. When he went back into heaven, mm-hmm. he received. He had authority here too to do this work, but ultimately he got all that authority when he went back.
That's right.
to the Father, and that's in Daniel 7. That term "Son of Man" is actually used there in Daniel chapter 7.
Yeah. Yeah, when he said it, and now is, mm-hmm. that was introduced, but it was brought to its. It was made an act of ministry when he returned to heaven. Mm-hmm. That is the phrase that Jesus referred to himself more frequently as Son of Man.
Amen.
All right.